matter what you're going through, I know that you can stand. For your life is in His hands.
your life is in his hands. Come on. Hallelujah. Train up a child in the way that they should go when they're old. They will not depart from that. You know how I know that? I mean, other than the fact that it's the word of God and it's true. How many of you remember, and I know she hates me doing this like all the time, but a little nausea when she was about that age. Amen. She'd be given a reading or something. And midway through, she'd be, but she'd make it through. She would make it through. And now she is training the next generation to do that. Come on. Thank you, Naja. Thank you, Happy Feet. Amen. Also want to acknowledge yet another younger element in our congregation that is having an opportunity to exercise their gifts. Don't know if you know, but we got Brother Little Romel Jr. on the drums. Y'all don't even notice. Amen. He ain't missed a beat all day. Praise God. We have said this before. We are really looking to unlock and utilize the amazing gifts and talents that are in our congregation at all kinds of levels. So if we recognize you as having a gift and a talent, and we tap on your shoulder for you to participate in some way, to share that with the friends and family, I really pray that your heart will be open to doing that. One real other brief announcement. I'm not sure how many of our executive board members are here, but if you are an executive board member 2018, I need no more than 10 of your minutes directly after service. Please meet me in the chapel. If we do have some other things going on there, we will relocate, but there's some very important information that I need to share with our executive board members, deacons, deaconess, ministry leadership team. If you could make that back there too, just something that we need to move forward in. Well, I've been in kind of a teaching mode, I think, all morning, and there's a little bit more that I need to share with you today. So let's get right into the Word of God. Take your Bibles in your hands, raise them before the Lord, and only if you believe them, let's repeat these words together. This is my Bible. This is God's Word speaking to me. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. It is the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. With it I wage war against the enemy of my soul. I will fight the good fight. I will contend for the faith. I will uphold the honor of God. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. We're going to be doing a lot of reading today, but I'm believing that this may, and I say may because I'm really not sure oft times when the Lord is going to end a series. And I know that I had given the media team a title of opening our spiritual eyes, which would make that part four in this series. But actually, it even ties into to be more like Jesus, because that was kind of the series that we started 2018. I think we ended 2017 and started 2018 with a series to be more like Jesus. That should be our heart's desire, because it is God's desire that when we talk about being Christian, the very term itself means Christ-like. And I believe that term, that Christianity and a lot of the things that had a certain connotation and meaning in the past has been hijacked for a multitude, for social reasons, for political gain, and for a multitude of things. And so we need to always make sure that the scripture is our blueprint, that we always refer to what God says about a thing, because society will change it, politics will taint it. Social norms that change from generation to generation will somehow feel that we can actually influence what God has said. We're talking about in Wednesday night Bible study. I'd like to invite those of you that may not be part of a small group or that may just want some additional teaching to come out to the Wednesday night Bible study at 7 p.m. here. Right now we are unpacking literally word by word and verse by verse, the letter from Jude. Jude is a very simple letter. He said that while he wanted to write about the common salvation that we all share, he said he really needed to urge the people of that time that they needed to contend for the faith that was once and for all delivered to the saints, because certain people had crept in among them unaware and had begun to introduce doctrines and teachings that weren't in line with Scripture. You've heard me say for quite some time now that there is a hybrid gospel being preached. There's a socially acceptable, politically correct version of this gospel that was delivered in the beginning when the Lord completed his work on earth, that has been changed, that has been altered. And I believe that there are people today who honestly believe that they are where they're supposed to be based upon this half-truth gospel. But even Paul said in the book of Galatians, he said that if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel than the one you have received, he said, let them be cursed. He says it immediately after, in case you didn't hear me. If you fall prey to, or if someone seeks to introduce to you something that they call the gospel, which really is no gospel at all, other than the gospel that was once and for all delivered to the saints, Paul said, let that person, let that man, let that woman be cursed. So we need to make sure, I need to make sure, that as a pastor and as a teacher, that what's going forth from this pulpit, what's going forth in our small groups, what's going on anywhere that the word of God is being preached, that we can pass it through the filter of God's word and have it come out complete on the other end. So we've been doing some teaching and some what I believe is some deep walks and deep dives into the word, because I truly believe, and I put my, again, for my notes, I need to push through this, because if I take the time to do everything that the Lord is going to be laying before us, it will take longer than I have. So I truly believe that the Spirit of the Lord has allowed me to be used by him in order to instruct us in what it means to be more like Jesus and what is involved in opening our spiritual eyes. These two series of messages have given insight into how we as a church and as individual believers can walk in the authority of the kingdom, having been seated there in Christ Jesus the moment we were sealed with the Holy Ghost. Now, I can say this too, that if you have not been here for the last few weeks and you haven't been a part of this series, that some of the things that are going to be said today may be head-scratching for you, but I can guarantee you they're verifiable and findable in the Scripture. And I would encourage you perhaps to go back online. Our messages are being posted on YouTube, or get yourself a CD to play in your car at your leisure, because we have been going by the Spirit of God leading us into some of the deeper things of God's Word. I mean, we even talked about how, and again, you would need to have to been there, how God can literally make you invisible to your enemies. Now, if you're just hearing that kind of right now, that sounds like, I don't want the guests to head forward the door. Just trust me in this, that when the Scripture says that in the time of trouble, he shall hide me, that means that God has the capacity to hide, to make you invisible to your enemies. Jesus was able to walk right back through a crowd of people that were getting ready to throw him off a cliff. He had the capacity to blind an entire army and lead them to a place where they could ultimately be destroyed. God has the capacity. Jesus has the capacity to do the supernatural. The Christian life, child of God, is a supernatural life. And I think that too many confessing Christians live our lives short of the glory that God has in store for us. And so these messages are intended kind of to prime that spiritual pump and the hunger for us to go a little bit deeper. Because the Bible says that we have already been seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And just like Paul said to the church in Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17 through 19, I keep asking. This is me talking. And we're going to look at this verse, Paul talking to the Ephesians. But this has become my prayer for this church. This has become my prayer for myself. This has become my prayer for every church that's open in his name. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we may know him better. Wisdom, the ability to take the word that we already know and apply it to your life. And revelation, a constant revealing and unfolding of the word of God that we just kind of hear and put in our minds. That he would give us the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we might know him better. I pray that the eyes of our understanding may be enlightened in order that we may know the hope to which he has called us, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us that believe. Incomparably great power. That means that we have resurrection power at our disposal. One amen in the back of the room. Resurrection power. You and I, child of God, we have the power that God used to raise Jesus from the dead is the same power that is at work in us. Jesus said that you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes up upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. What have we been saying? That power that God gives us is not just door-knocking power. It's not just leaflet on the corner power. It is the resurrection power of God that defeated death so that we could walk in an access of kingdom ability. You are citizens of a heavenly kingdom. And there is access, there are benefits to being a part of God's kingdom. But there is a consistent theme that runs through Paul's letter to the Ephesians. And having started this journey of our spiritual awakening in chapter 1, I want to conclude this series. Again, I'm calling this a conclusion, I'm not really sure. But I want to follow that same thread that started in chapter 1 and leads us today all the way to chapter 4. Hope you got your Bibles because you're going to need them today. We have gone through this teaching, actually the entire book of Ephesians, in Bible study several times. Matter of fact, I think we may have finished it last year or 2 years ago. It kind of takes us a while to go through the various books in the Bible because we're very, very thorough. And I believe that the best Bible study is not just something where you come and you learn something, but where you come and learn something that affects how you live. That you can take it home, you can take it to school, you can apply it immediately in your life. Remember what Jesus said at the end of the Sermon on the Mount? He said, whoever hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a man, a woman, who builds their house on a rock. Because guess what? Storms come, winds blow, wave crash, and beats on that house, and it stands because of its foundation. But those who hear these words and don't put them into practice, same house, same everything, different foundation. Builds their house on the sand. Guess what? Storms, winds, problems. Beats on that house and it collapses. I think too many people that go to church on a regular basis find that the things that God wants to build in us collapse because we are not putting his word into practice every day. That's just what I believe. This is not an indictment of anybody. But I find too many Christians oftentimes are seemingly struggling and needing an answer that God has already given. God has already given us in his word, and I think it's in Peter, God has given us everything we need for life and godliness in this present age. And yet and still, sometimes we run into problems and we run to God to do what God has given us the tools and the power to do. When our children were little and they needed you to come and, I don't know, pick up a box that they were too weak to pick up, any parent, you run and help your children. When you grow up a little bit, Daddy, can you pick up this box? I'm like, what's wrong with you? You obviously have the capacity, but we still want God to move the little boxes in our lives and not realize that he has given us the ability and the authority and the power to move them ourselves. It's going to get deeper in just a second. One thing that I failed to do, I want to recognize Pastor Brown from Lincoln Avenue. Pastor Brown and his lovely wife can just wave and bless them. They're visiting us, checking us out, going to go and report back to Pastor Cooper. So I need to be on my best behavior. Amen. Look, So we're going to walk through some scriptures. And again, I'm praying that you are going to be able to follow through because there's a thread. And this is going to be much more teaching, I think. And it just amazes me, too, that God has graced me with whatever kind of teaching gift that I have, that I could teach anybody anything is mind-blowing to me. Because I was never like the best student of anything. School was just like not my thing. I mean, you know, I was more of an entertainer than a student. But by God's grace, that when he started showing me in his word some things that I know that he wanted me to share with others, it keeps me incredibly humble. And Deacon Gene Madison and Deacon Marcus Williams, they keep saying this because Deacon Madison, who has since gone on to glory, would constantly, at the end of a service, if anything sounded remotely spiritual, he would say, "Boy, you ain't that smart." And I would say, "I know." So I'm praying today that as we walk through this, that we're going to be able to piece pieces of these chapters together, that you can go back and read the entire chapter, which you need to do anyway, so that you're just not getting something piecemeal and walking out of here with something that's not in God's word. So let's look at those verses again in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 19. And we're going to help you because they're going to be up on the screen also. But it's also good for you to be able to open your own Bible and find it yourself. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 19, Paul says this. He says, "For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers." I believe that the faith quotient is going up in friendship. I believe that our understanding and our faith in what God has said and what we can actually accomplish because we are children of that kingdom, that our faith is increasing. Jesus said that if we had faith as a grain of mustard seed, not that we had a little tiny speck of faith, but that we have the kind of faith that once that faith is planted in fertile soil, that it can produce something much greater. That God is increasing our faith, the essence of the seed that he's planting. And I can see it and hear it in the lives of so many people. So Paul said, "Since I heard about it, I have not stopped giving thanks for you." Watch this. "I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better." And you know what? I don't know if this week's program, is this on the cover of your program or was this just last week? You all have my prayer for you in your hand. You should cut this off and put it on your refrigerator. You should fold it up and put it in your purse, put it in your pocket. And this should become your own prayer. Pray that God would give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we might know him better, and that the eyes of your heart or your understanding might be enlightened or open, in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us that believe. That is the prayer of friendship. That God would give you wisdom. What do we say that wisdom was? Wisdom is learning how to apply the word that you already have. But if you're not implementing this message when you leave here, this is not going to do you any good. That if this is just a sermon that you hear and you can file it in your mind and say, "Yeah, I get it," but unless you really are applying it, then you are building your spiritual house on sand. What did Jesus say? If you hear these words but don't put them into practice, guess what's going to happen? The storms of life are going to come and beat on your house. Anybody in the midst of a storm, like right now, I mean, I don't need to know like your business, but I got one honest sister and the rest of us are just a whole lot better. Storms come. Winds blow. They are a part of life. And the fact of the matter is that if we're not prepared for the storms that are coming, then when they come, they're going to catch us off guard. The time to fix the leak in your roof is not when it's raining. You need to prepare for the rain. The time to put sandbags in front of your house is not in the middle of the flood. But how many people when the storms of life come, are seemingly totally spiritually unprepared. We're mad at God, we're mad at the devil, we're mad at the dog, we're mad at our wives, we're mad at everybody. Lord, why is this happening to me? Because you didn't put my word into effect in your life. Because the storms are going to come, child of God. This is not even prophetic. This is just natural. Storms come and winds blow. But if you're not going to put this into practice, that's wisdom. Lord, how can I take Sunday's message and apply it to what's going on in my marriage? How can I take Sunday's message and apply it between the difficulty with me and my son, with my financial struggles? I'm praying for a spirit of wisdom and revelation so that I can know God better. So that is the prayer. Now watch this. Go to chapter 2 and let's start in verse 4. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved. Verse 6. And God raised us up. Raised is past tense, is it not? So God raised us up with Jesus and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. I'm going to stop there in verse 7, 4 right now. When you got saved, child of God, your spiritual being was instantly transported to the place that God has in store for you. It says that we were seated the moment that you expressed faith in Christ Jesus. You were sealed by his spirit, and instantaneously, spiritually, you were seated in heavenly place. Am I making this up? Just let me make sure again, because y'all are looking kind of confused. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in order that in coming ages, he might show the incomparable riches of his grace. So, child of God, you have been seated in a heavenly realm. And if I'm already seated in that heavenly realm, it implies that I have access already to what's in that realm. I live in this realm, but I exist in that realm. That's why the scripture constantly tells us, don't look at what you can see down here, because everything down here changes. But everything up there is eternal. All my help comes from the Lord. So if I've been seated there, I need to begin to act and think and talk and live like I am a foreigner in a strange land. Because where I come from, all my needs are met. Where I come from, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Where I come from, I can do all things through Christ, because this world will do all that it can to convince me that that's not my reality. But my reality is not this one. I have been seated already in heavenly places. Drop down to verse 11. Therefore, remember, this is going to be important. Please remember this, that formerly, what does formerly mean? It means before now, right? It means it means in my past. Formerly, that you who are Gentiles by birth. That means that unless you are Jewish, you're a Gentile. Y'all follow that? That there is a Jew and there's a Gentile. And so if you were not a natural born Jew, you're a Gentile. But also, if you're not a spiritual born child of God, you remain a Gentile. This is going to be very important. Watch this. Remember that you formerly were called Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves circumcised, which is done in the body, by human ethics. Remember that at that time, you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of promise, without hope and without God. Please do not fall for this gospel that says that God loves everybody the same. He loves the world because he creates it. But there are those that belong to his family, and there are those that don't. I love all children. But I love my children a little bit different. I treat them different. I hold them to a different standard. One thing, and I can say this because nobody in here that I know has this problem, I have a hard time with bad little kids. I have a hard time keeping myself composed because I'm looking at the mom and say, are you paying attention to your child crawling all across the countertop? I got to eat on that. They slapping you and telling you to shut up. What? Time out. I'm a quote Deacon Davis and he ain't even here. We didn't do time out. We did time's up. You got one more again to do that. So the Bible says that before you came to Christ, you were a Gentile. You were a foreigner. You were without God. You were without hope. You had no connection to God whatsoever. Please do not let anybody tell you that there is not a difference between us and them. Those that are not a part of God's spiritual family are foreigners. They are excluded. Remember, what does the Bible say? Don't forget this. Remember that at that time, you, now watch this, before you come down too hard on other people, remember that all of us were in this category once before. So don't get the spiritual big head and don't start looking down your spiritual nose at them Gentiles. When a Gentile walks in the church, please remember that they're Gentile. They're not saved. Why are they dressed like that? Because they ain't you yet. Why they walk like that? Why they talk like that? Why they smell like that? Why they drink like that? Because they're Gentiles. They might know about God, but remember this. They were foreigners, excluded from citizenship, foreigners to the covenants, without hope, and without God. But now in Christ, you, who once were far away, have been brought near. See, listen, this is part of this gospel. We are talking about becoming more like Jesus. We're talking about having your spiritual eyes open. The only way that you're going to open your eyes is if you're born into the things of God. The only way that God can open your spiritual eyes is for him to give you birth into a new life so that you can see a dimension that you belong in. You are a citizen of a heavenly kingdom. And until you gain access to that kingdom by being born into it, you will believe that everything is the way it's supposed to be because this is the only reality that you know. You will try to make sense of God based on this reality. You will get caught up in all of this political garbage, believing that somehow by making things right politically, that somehow God is pleased. This world is lost. The democratic world, the Republican world, the American world, apart from Jesus, are foreigners, excluded, without hope, and without God. I hope that that confronts something in you. Says, how dare you speak about my nation? I love this country. Not even but. Because elsewhere, got a whole other problem. Even being poor here ain't like being poor somewhere else. Oh, this country got problems. But you see, even in this amazing country that I live in, my citizenship is not here. I live here, but my citizenship is in heaven. I feel like I'm struggling with simple truth. Let's just keep on going. Let me do what I said I was going to do and keep pushing. He said, consequently, where did I stop? Verse 13, but now in Christ, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus. Drop down to verse 19. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household. Built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling place in which God lives by his Spirit. Do you know that God is trying to build you into a temple worthy of him living in? Even in my own thinking, there's a standard that I have to where I live. This is not looking down on anybody. But there's a standard that in my 59 years, 32 years of married life, 33 this year. This year, I fixed it. I won't go. 29 years of being a father. There's some things that I've learned. There's a standard that I've set for my family. And if we had to move from where we were, I'd be hard-pressed to lower my standard unless I absolutely had to. Because I've experienced life at this level. This is not a boast. This is just basic, to me, common sense. When I came into a knowledge of what God has done in my life, it's hard for me to try to adjust my spiritual sails for a level that he has called me higher from. That I can kind of hang around with folks and try to, you know, just kind of make them feel comfortable. But when God has blessed you, and it's not an arrogant thing, it's a confidence thing. Somebody put it like this. I can't hang out with turkeys when I'm used to soaring with eagles. Are y'all following what I'm trying to say? Do you understand the words coming out of my mouth? God has called us out of darkness. And so many of us, not us, but some other folks, too many people are comfortable with the level of darkness that they live in, and therefore they simply don't rise to that place that God has called us to. We've become comfortable with the level of sin we allow into our lives. Help me, Father God, get to this point. Because I'm going to step on somebody's toes, but it ain't my shoe. God is trying to build us. Now go to Ephesians 3. Again, we're putting something together. Ephesians 3. I said 3. Verse 14. For this reason. What reason? For the reason that God is building us up to be a holy temple. Paul said, for this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, that he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. What does it mean for Jesus to dwell in your heart? I mean, you know, is it kind of just a warm, fuzzy feeling? Jesus is in my heart. Why? What is he doing in there? Does he have rule and reign and control of your life? Is he guiding and changing the way you think and the way you act? And is he really Lord of your life, or is he just a tenant in a room that he pays rent on? So the Christ will dwell in your heart by faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. What does that mean? That you might be filled to the fullest measure of God. I don't know about you, but I'm not at that place yet. But the Bible says that that's where God wants us to be. And I believe that we've got too much other stuff in our lives, too much other things that we become comfortable with to be full of God. We're too full of ourselves. We're full of our political opinion. We're full of our own personal desires. And God wants us to get to a place where we become so full of him that we are full to the very measure of the extent that God could fill anything. Okay. See, because we love this next part. Now unto him that's able to do exceedingly and abundantly of all we ask or think. Oh, we love that part. But notice it says now. See, now comes after something. He says God wants you to fill God wants to fill you to the fullest measure of God in your life. And when you reach that place now, unto him that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you ask or think, it's according to the power that's working in you. You know why sometimes that we don't see things happen in our lives? Because we're waiting on God to exert his power when he's given us his power. But we don't have his power because we expect him to use his. Daddy, lift this box. No. Lift your own cotton picking box. Daddy, help me through this problem. No. Figure it out yourself. I tell you a story, and I know folks get tired of me telling my kid's story. Camille with, you know, babies. She's sitting between me and Janine. And she's sitting there, and she used to suck her fingers like this. And I'm glad she's not here because I'd embarrass her to do that. She used to suck her finger like this. And she popped her fingers out, twisting the hair in the back. She said, bottle, Daddy. Old enough to talk. Old enough to walk. You don't ever get your own bottle. They got to learn somehow. So I said, baby, you go in the refrigerator. Bottle, Daddy. I said, baby, the bottle isn't there. Lucious, don't be like that. Janine's not here either, so I can do this too. I said, she got to learn eventually. So, you know, like my mother would say, like when she would fix dinner, and I said, I didn't want it. She said, well, you ain't hungry enough. So I mean, she crawls out the bed, and now she's, now she's weak. She can't open the door. She's looking at me, snotting and crying. I said, pull, baby. I said, grab it and lean back. Ultimately, she pulled it, grabbed it, hopped up in it, happy as a clam. How long God going to have to get your bottle, child of God? How long is God going to have to get you out of all of the things that he's given you the ability and his word to get yourself out of? When are you going to start laying hands on your own self? When are you going to speak life into your own family? When are you going to get to that place so that you can do what this said? You've got to be filled. See, but you've got to be filled to the measure. If you've got too much of you in the way, then God is never going to be able to reach a place where he can say, now you've got power, you do it. I get the glory, you get the reward. God always gets the glory. But listen, for God to open your eyes, he's opening your eyes to see something that he has in store for you. See, on first Sunday, man, we were shouting and laughing and crying. Pastor, that's one of the best messages that you preached. This brother said that to me. He said, well, what I've been doing for the last 20 some odd years? And I got it because I got a lot out of it. But we need to understand that messages aren't just given us to enjoy. To walk out of church, ooh, that was wonderful. What you going to do with it? Are your eyes open yet? Are you learning how to exercise your faith yet? That God wants to get you to a place where you are so full of him that now, unto him who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that works in you. God has given you everything that you need, child of God, to face down every demon in your life, to step up to every challenge in your life. But if you got more of you than him, you'll always lose that battle. Now unto him that is able to exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think according to his power that works in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout ages forever. Turn to chapter 4. I'm going to cut something off. I was going to give you this last piece. Verse 17. And I'm coming to a quick close. So I tell you this. Y'all talking about power and being a temple of the Spirit and having a power. Y'all really want that? Two people do. The rest of you aren't sure until we read this. Y'all saying, well, hold up till I read this next part, and then I'll tell you. See, but I told you that there's a thread. This leads up to this. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord that you must no longer live like the Gentiles. Remember what we said about the Gentiles? Foreigners. Excluded. Without hope and without God. They got the best TV shows. They got the funniest comedians. They seem to have the livest parties. Don't get so sanctified now, y'all. See, we love hanging out with the Gentiles because they remind us of where we used to be. And somehow we've also this ongoing thing, well, you shouldn't judge people. Don't judge people. I don't have to judge people. The Bible already has judged them. Everybody that's without Jesus is a foreigner to his kingdom. Doesn't say that God doesn't love them. Doesn't say that God's not going to bless them. They're just not part of his family. See, when I go home and I close the door, now even though my kids got keys, my grown adult tenant children have keys, at a certain time of day, not just anybody's going to walk in my house. Especially if I don't know you. And even if I do know you, if you're not family, because I got this big black gate in front of my house on purpose. That's a good 4 feet from the front door. I don't even have to come to the gate. I can talk through the window. What do you want? And I do. But the Bible talks about a time when God closes the door of opportunity. It's called the dispensation of grace coming to an end. And those that do not belong to his family will be foreigners. They will be excluded. And they will be without God and without hope. See, we don't want to deal with that hard truth. But the Bible says very, very plainly that it comes a time where God insists, child of God, that if we're going to be what God wants for us, and I'm talking to myself too, because I got too much Gentile in me. Why'd you say that so loud? Amen, pastors, man. I know you got some Gentile. But he says, I insist, watch this, that you no longer live like the Gentiles do. Come on, technology. They are darkened in their understanding, and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Remember we looked in the book of Matthew and we saw this verse that said the lamp, the eye is the lamp of the body. And if your eye is good, then your whole body is full of light. But if your eye is bad, then your whole body will be full of darkness. If the light in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Light speaks to information, spiritual information. And just like your eye, your natural eye, processes light, and therefore you can have an understanding of your world. Your spiritual eye needs to be open so that you can perceive what God has said. But if your eyes are bad, if your eyes are natural, then what you're receiving is information from a dark and a lost world. When we're watching all the shows that entertain us, you're entertaining yourself with darkness. When your favorite comedian starts going a little bit farther than you know that you should go and tell jokes that you wouldn't tell your mama, or you sure wouldn't come to church and tell, or some of y'all do, but you ain't worried about that anyway because you still got more Gentile in you than saint. Then that means that the information, the light that is in us, the information is darkness. And so we don't have to judge darkness because darkness judges itself. That's why, you know, this judging thing, I don't have to judge you, I just need to watch you. And you just have to watch me, because a tree is known by its fruit. And a good tree cannot bear bad fruit. So the Bible says, and we're again, I'm closing on this point. Paul says, I insist. We got to stop living like the Gentiles, folks. We got to stop living by the world. That doesn't mean that you got to be a hermit and go bury yourself in some cave, and you got to live some puritanical life, and everything is thee and thou and thus saith. It just means that there's a standard that God calls us to. Amen. He says, I insist because they are separated from God. Are you separated? Ask yourself that question. What in your life separates you from God? What do you enjoy so much that if you had to give it up, it would be very, very difficult? You know what that's called? It's called an acceptable sacrifice. You know what I got a big problem with? My cell phone. Because everything I have, all my information, emails, texts, Netflix, internet, contacts, all on the cell phone. And I find myself reaching for that cell phone. Can I tell you something and be honest? I find myself reaching for my cell phone more often than I reach for my Bible. That's not saying I don't reach for my Bible, but I reach for my cell phone almost more readily and more frequently. Yeah, I got a Bible app on it, but oftentimes that's not what I'm enjoying. I'm not saying abject evil. I'm just talking about darkness, Gentile stuff, foreigner, excluded from God stuff that takes up way too much of my time. I'm praying that God open my spiritual eyes, but I'm spending too much time with my natural eyes looking at the things that entertain me. Am I alone in this thing? So Paul's saying, listen, I insist that if we're going to be the kind of people that God is looking for as a church and as individuals, we got to stop spending so much time living like the Gentiles. They're darkened in their understanding, separated from the life of God because of the ignorance. Having lost all sensitivity, they've given themselves over to sensuality. Remember what we talked about, that word? Sensuality does not always mean sexuality. It means that we are dominated by our senses. But what we see, what we taste, what we feel, what we can get out of this life. Spirituality and sensuality are two different worlds. We are so governed by how we feel about a thing as opposed to what God says about a thing. And I have to learn how to go with what God says as opposed to what I feel, because my feelings are rooted in this world and this world is lost. I have to learn how to transform my mind to present my body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, and stop being conformed to this world. This has been much more of a straight and direct message than perhaps the other ones were. But do you want God to open your eyes? Just, do you want to be more like Jesus? Do you want to be the head and not the tail? Do you want to be able to speak into your circumstances and watch every demon in your life flee? Or are you comfortable with the level that you're at? Are you comfortable with what the Gentile world has to offer? And by Gentile, I'm speaking of the non-spiritual things. Or do you want to be a part of God's kingdom? Kingdom responsibility calls for a kingdom commitment. See, I can only say this to you because I don't hold that much sway over your life. These are the kind of things I'm about to say oft times that gets me in trouble. But why should I stop now? And I want you to hear this. Please understand where I'm coming from. I love everybody, and I hope that you love me too. But see, to actually be your pastor, that means that I have a degree of authority to speak over and into your life and to expect you not to uphold my standards, but the standards of God's word that I speak to you. And because some people will never let anybody, I ain't gonna let no man, let no pastor tell me nothing. Because watch this, somebody will say, don't you let that pastor tell you anything. That's your relationship. That's your relationship with God. I'm telling you what God says. But for some folks, pastors, we're more spiritual advisors. Because you can kind of take what you like, leave what you don't, and help it make sense. Paul said because he was so invested in this church that God had birthed it under the unction and the anointing of the Spirit of God on him. Paul said, as the apostle of your faith, I got to insist. Stop living like the Gentiles. And if anybody considers me your pastor today, as much as I can say that to you, I need to insist because I'm talking to myself. We, you and I, must stop living like the Gentiles. We need to start looking at the stuff that entertains us. We need to start looking at the stuff we spend our time on. We need to start weighing out what it is that God wants and what it is that he doesn't. I have clothes in my closet that I have not worn in a long time. But because they're still mine, and because I might wear them sometime in the future, they're just in there. But they're taking up space. They serve no real purpose. I've got to get rid of some stuff. Stuff that's not bad, it's just in the way. for Christians today, there's a lot of stuff that clutters our mind. A lot of extraneous things that just don't glorify God. And if I could say this to you, to be more like Jesus and to have your spiritual eyes open, we've got to stop living like the Gentiles. So, Father God, today, Father, your word is truth. And sometimes it is just hard truth, Lord, that we need in our lives. Of all the people, Lord, in the world, to speak a word to your people, I am the least likely and the least worthy. Because as I teach and preach to others, oh God, you are bringing that conviction to my heart. God forbid that I should preach to others and I myself be a castaway. Lord, I want my eyes to open so brightly and so wide that I can see you in your full glory. I want everything in my life that's not like you, Lord, to be laid aside so that I can experience your fullness. But I've got to stop living like the Gentiles. I've got to stop hanging out with those that are excluded, have no hope, and have no God, and surround myself with brothers and sisters that are in this struggle together. I pray this word, Lord, today would find a fertile place, a little more difficult, a little more straight, but your word. Anything, Lord, that I spoke that was not directed by your spirit, let it fall to the ground. But I pray that the rest of it, Lord, would penetrate, that this word would be like a sharp sword that gets down and digs into our spirit and uproots everything that's not like you so that we can grow more and more. Have your way, oh God, in Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. Praise God. Father God, thank you. Now I was just doing that for myself.